I want to thank our guest speakers tonight, Dr. Bork and Dr. Piedra, for their excellent presentation. I want to thank also the two co-chairs of this program who really worked very hard, Dr. Roy Shomali and Dr. Adachi, for preparing this really excellent mini symposium. Dr. Shomali is really well known to all of us, but I'd like to introduce him with enthusiasm. He is the director of the clinical virology program at University of Texas MD Anderson Cancer Center, well known to most of us in this room. He is also director of the infection control program and has done a great job in both tracks. And he's also an adjunct associate professor at the UT School of Public Health and the Baylor College of Medicine. Dr. Shomali has moved the field of clinical virology, including research in the field, in a tremendous way, and he will be speaking about what's new in the field of paramyxoviral infections. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Rani. Okay.
I promise this is the last talk of tonight. Okay. Let me find mine. Okay, great. So I'm going to talk about the paramyxoviruses and what we've been doing over the past few years at MD Anderson regarding management. Talk a little bit more about treatment, what's in the pipeline, and how we're addressing this kind of infection nationally also. And these are my disclosures. And this is the outline of my talk. I'm going to start talking about the burden of this infection in immunocompromised patient, cancer patient, but also about how we can stratify patients into risk groups in order to really manage them better, being a little bit more aggressive, treating or not treating. And also at the end, talking about the new drugs that are in the pipeline. And I'm going to focus on two viruses because of the sake of time. I'm going to talk about RSV mainly, and at the end, a little bit about parainfluenza infection. So I will encourage you to read this nice review article. It was published in CID recently. Actually, we collaborated with Michael and Dimpy did a great job in putting it together about how management of respiratory viral infections in immunocompromised patients, mainly stem cell transplant, but also leukemia and lymphoma patient. All you need to know as of today about this kind of, about management actually. But we all know that it is, you know, every winter season we see lots of patients with this kind of infection. Unfortunately, in immunocompromised patients, they come down with this kind of infection and could be pretty serious infection. It can cause pneumonia, and that's what we worry about. It could be up to 50% of the time, but also it can affect mortality or affect survival in this patient. We tend to forget also the late complications of this infection, which are bronchiolitis obliterans syndrome that can occur later on after the infection in this type of patient population as well. The risk factors for this kind of infection, or for progression actually, for worse outcome, are, you see it listed here based on many studies published, mainly from Fred Hutch, from our institution, and also from Europe, looking at age, smoking history, receipt of allotransplant, mismatch versus graft versus host disease, and also neutropenia, lymphopenia, that everyone agree with other risk factors. And these are very important because this will give us an idea who are really not going to be doing well after this infection, or who are going to recover quickly and not going to have any complications from that. But also what we worry about most, and we know from many studies, as soon as the patient develops pneumonia, then it's different ball game. Then become very, you know, at risk of even dying with this infection, meaning they may progress to respiratory failure and die with multi-organ failure at the end. So that's what we need and try to prevent this kind of progression in order to really have impact on survival. So the burden of respiratory viruses, this is a pretty heavy slide, but the table. But if you can see, actually, when we looked at our data for RSV, influenza, and parainfluenza, I want you to focus on total It's almost around 427 patients when you look at stem cell lymphoma and leukemia, but look also at the type of nosocomial infection may occur in this patient population. It's not insignificant. And this is, you know, this is our job as infection control, as healthcare workers, when we deal with these patients, to make sure we don't transmit this to them, either us or maybe visitors. So we take it very seriously because patient may die with this infection. Influenza, the same thing. You look at the nosocomial infection, also could be between 1 to 5% or even 3% as a total, as an average, but still is something that we need to do something about, and we have mandatory program for vaccination. Hopefully this will prevent some of this nosocomial transmission. Parainfluenza, another virus that sometimes we tend to forget, but also can cause many infections. This data actually was collected or were looked at. This is at the time when we didn't do PCR you know, in our institution. So this is probably much underestimation of the number of cases we see per year. And I'm gonna show you on the next slide, as you see here, that over the past few seasons, when we start doing PCR actually here, you see the peak is much higher for influenza and for RSV, and same thing probably for parainfluenza, besides seeing trend of increasing. It has to do either with the season was much more heavy in case of exposure, or also because we have more sensitive tests and we're diagnosing more patients with this kind of infection. Because for a long time, you know, when we had unsensitive tests, we know that patients have all the respiratory symptoms, we get the DFA or culture negative, you know, what does mean, kill them on isolation? Most probably they have one of the respiratory viruses. But the most common virus that we see in a huge amount actually over the past year when we start doing this is rhinovirus. Over probably 4 month period, we had 500 cases of rhinovirus infection. Only few nosocomial, although we had some nosocomial, but mainly coming in. These patients, you know, so far, we're gonna look more into detail, but it wasn't really kind of bad virus circulating and causing lots of severe infection in these patients. So it was probably minimal or mild infection as well. So let's talk about measures. So this is the burden, that's what we see, and you know, and it's all over, you know, it's all over the state during the winter season. It is something pretty cumbersome, pretty common. How we manage this patient if they have paramyxoviral infection? So the first question, so when I started here around more than 12 years ago, I was pretty interested in looking at RSV and managing RSV, but they have so many questions at that point, you know, especially when we use ribavirin, which is the aerosolized form of ribavirin, it was pretty controversial. It's very expensive drug. You have to put patient, you know, in, I think I have a picture later. Here, and under the tent for someone who didn't take care of this patient, that's what patients go through actually when they have RSV infection and need to be treated. They sit in the tent. This is generator of ribavirin that you see here, and patient will breathe in the this medication, this compound in and out. We used to keep them in the tent 18 hours a day. Out of the 24 hours a day, until we did the study randomizing patient to 18 hours versus 3 hours every 8 hours, and we found the same impact, so we moved away from this 18 hours a day. But it is pretty, you know, it take a lot of toll on, you know, big toll on our patient to be isolated like that and being in a tent to treat. So the first question to came to us is like, do we need to treat first this patient, because the data is pretty controversial, small case series, not much of good evidence out there. Treat all or only high-risk patients, this is the next question. So if we, and you know, if we convince that ribavirin have some impact, but do we have to treat every patient with RSV infection? And if we wanna treat only high-risk patients, how we can be consistent in identifying high-risk patients in this patient population? The other question, we answered the intermittent versus continuous in one randomized trial. The combination is still controversial, we're not sure yet, and the cost effectiveness, hopefully we'll have some new data in the near future. We're looking into this as well. So the first question, do we need to treat or not with ribavirin? And you'll be surprised. We are strong believer. I know Fred Hutch, strong believer in ribavirin. But when you talk to other investigators in other big cancer centers, they're not. You know, either they don't see much of RSV or they don't see much of severe RSV infection, and they don't believe that this patient, their patient, need to be treated. Although I was telling them, you know, show me the data that it is really true, because, you know, I didn't see any data generated in people who don't believe in ribavirin. So, and this is also in our review article in CID, where what we put there is the impact of ribavirin on either pneumonia or progression to LRTI versus all-cause mortality. If you look at the upper, this graph here, and we try to control for the time of diagnosis, either before 2001 or after 2001, to control for supportive care impact. And actually what we found, that patients who were treated, who were on antiviral therapy before or after 2001, they had less progression to pneumonia versus the one who were not treated at all, and that doesn't matter what time period as well. And this is based on 280 patients that we saw over past probably 15 years at MD Anderson. But also what was interesting, it's all-cause mortality actually that we looked at day 90, and we found impact also of ribavirin when they were treated versus not treated. You have big difference in all-cause mortality. This is the first time someone showed that, and this is probably because we had a big number of patients to account for that. But what Michael did in his cohort, looking at impact of ribavirin on a patient with RSV LRI, and he found the same thing. So after progression, if you treat this patient with ribavirin or systemic ribavirin, but what he found that the impact was more significant for aerosolized ribavirin versus no treatment at all, where you have higher mortality rate, and the one who got systemic antiviral. So based on this data, you can tell that, you know, ribavirin has some impact on this patient, either on progression to lower respiratory tract infection versus even mortality rate that you see here. So, but what we did, we were also interested to see do we have more data out there? And we didn't find much of randomized controlled trial. I know Michael tried for years to complete his trial. It was very hard to enroll for many understandable reasons. It's very hard to get patients on this trial, especially when you do multi-center trial. And but he found also, I don't have a slide on that, some impact of aerosolized ribavirin on the viral load versus placebo. But now these days, if you ask me why we don't do a trial of aerosolized ribavirin and versus placebo, I would say it's unethical. Based on all the data, although it's retrospective data or some observational data collected prospectively, and based on our review that we did around a few years ago, where we put together all articles published or literature published on RSV management and progression to LRI versus mortality, and we found difference in patients who were treated. They had lower progression versus lower mortality versus patient untreated was that higher. It's not controlled data, but at least some signal. So if you come back to me and ask me why we don't do it, I would say unethical to do that in even future study, and most of the probably investigator will agree with me on that. So this is the first question. Do we need to treat? I would say yes. I started about virin. As of today, probably is the way to go until we get more data on oral ribavirin. I'm going to show you some of this later. So if we need to treat, do we need to treat everyone? I would say no. And we know some of the patients will do well without treatment. But some of other patients, they may not, and they may progress, and we have worse outcome. So the other question was, how can we identify high-risk patients? Because this will help us to stratify patients into different risk groups. And that's what we did in our group, and this is the work of Dimpy, looking at try to stratify patients by creating an immunodeficiency scoring index. So if you have kind of index number, which the transplanter love to see that, and below this number you're at low risk, above this number you're at high risk, based on data, either lab data that you have available at the bedside or some or data you can get it from patient, medical data from patient. So want to make it easy. It's not like you have to wait for a test that could be sent somewhere and wait for the result or do something more complicated. We want to know at the bedside, when I see this patient, I have this basic routine, lab work, are they at risk for this infection progressing or not? So what we found, actually, different modeling that we did, including and removing some of the variables, what we found that mainly neutropenia, as you see it here, less than 500, or lymphocytopenia, less than 200, had the highest adjusted hazard ratio, and they got the highest weighted score. Because not every risk factor behaved the same or had the same weight, when you compare to each other. Age has a good scoring. And the rest, they had a low hazard ratio, but still we know that these are risk factors for progression based on many data. That's why we include them in the model and we give them a low assigned weight. And we came out with up to 12, this is the maximum weight, a score that they can get. If the 0 to 2 is low risk, between 3 and 6 is moderate risk, which is this little bit of the gray zone, and the high risk, 7 to 12. So based on, and this is a part of the modeling, based on these graphs, that's how we identify and try to, created the score and try to not validate the score, but try to look at the scoring based on antiviral versus no antiviral therapy. And what's interesting, if you look at the solid lines on the left side, which is the progression to LRTI, what you see is that if they were not treated, the high-risk patient not treated, most of them will progress to pneumonia. And the moderate risk versus the low risk, around 20 to 25% will progress to pneumonia. The one who were treated, actually, the high-risk patient, if they were treated with ribavirin, the risk go down from 100% down to less than 20%. And also, same thing for the low risk, it go down, but not that big of the deal. But moderate risk also went down a little bit. But we're interested, is it only preventing progression to pneumonia? What about impact on mortality or RSV-associated mortality in this cohort that we looked at? We found that it had an impact on mortality as well. If not treated, you have higher risk of dying from RSV or with RSV. But for the moderate risk, it was around 4%. If they were treated, and for the low risk, it didn't matter. Treated or not treated, no impact on mortality. So you can argue that moderate risk, little bit impact on mortality, around 4%, but if you save one patient, maybe it's good. But the low risk, this is the strong data, you should be treating the high risk, and the low risk you shouldn't be treating because there's no impact on mortality, and the high risk you should be treating because there is good impact on mortality. So based on this data, and that's what we do at MD Anderson, when you have anyone coming with respiratory symptoms, and then you get a nasal wash from the BL or a nasal wash or from getting RSV from the nasal wash or BL, you put them on isolation, you get chest x-ray. If they have RSV only in the upper, negative chest x-ray, now based on our data, we treat only moderate to high risk. Although I want to probably try to move away from moderate, maybe we should see in the moderate group which one should not be treated. But for now, that's what we're doing, and we're using the intermittent regimen of ribavirin. 3 hours on, 5 hours off, 3 hours on, 5. So we decrease from 18 hours a day down to 9 hours a day and not, together. It's like separate by 5 hours off. And anyone with RSV pneumonia, either proven by BL or not, or coming with bilateral infiltrate with RSV, they will get ribavirin for sure. We add IVIG. And I mentioned earlier, before, that we do with why we use IVIG, I think it has some anti-inflammatory effect and decrease the inflammation in the lung, and usually patient will do better. We're not using palivizumab anymore over the past many years now. We're doing ribavirin and IVIG. So by doing this, stratifying patient into low risk, moderate, and high risk, actually what happened, we looked at our data to see how many low risk were treated actually when they're not supposed to be treated. It was 50% of the low risk population. It was the biggest population that we had at low risk. 50% were not treated, were not supposed to. But also what's interesting, that 50% of the high risk were not treated for different reasons at that time and when it was really indicated. So by applying the scoring system, we can save lots of money by not treating patients and also treating patients who need to be treated as well. If you extrapolate this number to bigger patient population, you're going to see how much the saving is. And that's what we're applying now in our, you know, and that's what this our stem cell transplant people are doing based on our scoring system. Although I still get called if you need to treat or not. Different story. So this is actually this is a new data. I just got the slide from Dimpy. We're working on it for the past few weeks in hematologic malignancy, lymphoma, and leukemia patient. So what the impact of therapy on that? And we had 181 cases. This is probably the biggest series in this patient population, looking at RSV LRI with or without treatment. You know, to summarize that. Leukemia patient, interestingly enough, if they were not treated, they had higher rate of progression to pneumonia. Lymphoma, they had a little bit higher rate of progression, but mortality was not affected. Leukemia, it was. So if you don't treat, you have higher mortality with RSV. And this is all-cause mortality, actually. At day 90, it was, in fact, if you treated versus not treated. So there's some kind of signal here telling us even leukemia patient, maybe we should study it a little bit more, identify the high-risk patient, and probably treat versus no treat. Probably this can be done under protocol. And if you ask me, maybe placebo, I would say probably. We have to think about it. But something can be done. Lymphoma, I don't think really... they have big impact on mortality with RSV. We didn't see difference in treatment versus no treatment. So what's on the horizons? There's many few interesting stuff coming down our way. The first one is the RSV, the hyperimmune RSV immunoglobulins or enriched RSV titers. And this is developed by ADMA Biologics. It's gonna come to the market through different routes, through the SCID syndrome where they got this and tried to prove, they got this compound, tried to prove decrease in infectious etiologies. So we may, tested soon in our patient population, but this after get approval. The other one, which is very exciting, the fusion inhibitors also, and I'm going to talk a little bit about it later. And the third one, I don't think it's going to continue to be developed anymore. The first trial was done in lung transplant, although they found, very interestingly, they decreased the risk of BO, or bronchiolitis obliterans, but it was not moved forward. And I will tell you something, based on our experience, we've been doing this for years, and Michael can vouch for this as well. It's so hard to design trial in this patient population. What will be your primary endpoint? What will be your secondary endpoint? How you can prove that? Is it pneumonia? What kind of pneumonia? How you can prove it's only RSV? It's not bacterial. It's not fungal. What about viral load? It's not validated also. Is it high viral load versus low viral load? And now if you're going to go to all-cause mortality, it's harder also. Then how much you need? You need maybe 500 patients. They're going to take 10 years or 15 years to enroll 500 patients on the stem cell transplant who got RSV and tried to prevent. So it is. We're struggling with that. Although in phase two, it's easier because you can have viral load as primary endpoint versus oxygen supplement or other stuff. But in phase three, it's going to be pretty hard unless we get good data to correlate maybe viral load with progression and with mortality. The last one, I'm going to show you some data, the oral ribavirin. So everyone talk about it, nothing new, it's been on the market forever. In Europe, they use more probably oral ribavirin than we do here in the state. And before I said, you know, we talked about a lot, but I said, you know, we don't have good data. Let's first test it under protocol before we recommend to be used in RSV infection, especially on the stem cell transplant. So this is the, it's ongoing open label randomized trial, try to prevent progression. Okay, from URI to LRI in stem cell transplant. And we're doing also viral load as well as neutralizing antibody with Dr. Piedra's lab, and we're getting very interesting data from his lab as well on this, and he showed you some of this data. So, but how are we doing it? And this is the interesting part, because we try to validate our scoring system at the same time. We have three arms of this study where the low risk, we said, you know, and took me a long time, after discussing with the stem cell transplant, to convince them not to treat this patient. And they agree with that now based on the previous data and this data. Low risk observation. And we follow them on a weekly basis, make sure they don't progress, they don't have any issues, and we don't have any sign of pneumonia. The moderate to high risk, we randomize them oral versus aerosol ribavirin, and also we're getting nasal wash at different days. And you know, so far we enrolled around 48 patients, thanks to Shashank's effort, great effort to get this patient on this protocol. It is very hard. We think that, you know, we have so many RSV in our stem cell. Actually, most of the time we couldn't enroll because patient was not eligible. Either they had a pneumonia in most of the time, or they were outside the window, or for some reason that we couldn't enroll. So it's not that easy. Every season we're getting probably around between 15 to 18 patients, but not more. But this is data actually from last season. So far we didn't analyze the new patient. This is up to 28 patients, where we found, which is interesting. And if I show you here, this is actually when you go down below 40, meaning viral load becomes almost undetectable or undetectable. This is the CT count. It's not viral load on the left side. But what you need to know, this is the threshold of 40, where below it is undetectable. But what's interesting, patient who got oral ribavirin, actually, you know, they had some decrease in viral load up to the last visit, which is usually up to 4 weeks from treatment, and no one got below undetectable level. But we didn't have any progression to pneumonia in this patient. I'm talking about high risk versus moderate risk on this in this trial. So they did not progress, but they didn't have much of impact on viral load. And my theory or my hypothesis is, you know, we're getting probably good level in the lung and preventing infection in the lung, but we didn't have enough in the sinus to decrease the viral load from the nasal wash at that point. But if you look at aerosolized ribavirin, you see the big drop at day 14 became negative. So if they get aerosolized, it makes sense, nasal wash, the viral load will go down. But we had two patients, one who his viral load on aerosolized ribavirin went up after 3 days, and patient died, progression to pneumonia and died. And the other one, same thing, who did not become negative, he had LRI, but he did not die. So what's telling me, the viral load, it can depict some picture, can help us to predict who will do well or not, but only for aerosolized ribavirin and not for probably oral ribavirin. Now, for the one who are on observation therapy, all of them got a viral load below zero or undetectable at day 14, except one who did not, and this is the only one who progressed. To pneumonia, but did well after was aerosolized. And actually, this one, we look more close into it. I don't think he will fit the lower. Based on our scoring system, which is not perfect, this patient had a little bit of hypoxemia 2 days before we enroll him, and probably had some degree of bronchiolitis obliterans before we enroll him. That's why probably he did not respond on observation, was no treatment. But most of the other patients, which we have around 20 patient under observation, and all of them did well except one with no treatment at all. So this is the new compound from Gilead, actually, which is a fusion inhibitor. It's very interesting. It will prevent attachment of the RSV and entry phase of the virus inside the cells, and also the syncytial formation of RSV between the cells and infective virus. It's an oral drug given every 3 days, actually has long acting. And they have a very nice study by DeFisenzo where they did this challenge study. They give healthy volunteer RSV, and after a few days, they treat them with this versus placebo. And this was done in England and UK, where they can do that. It was very nicely done study with the challenge study. And what they found very interesting, when they compared the viral load after inoculation of the virus and administering either placebo or the oral diffusion inhibitors, decrease in viral load within a few days versus increase on the placebo. They also weighted mucus. So they give them tissue, you know, and they weighted the tissue, see how much mucus we're producing, and it was much less on the fusion inhibitor versus the placebo, and the total symptoms was also, the scoring system was also less in this patient. So it looks like it's very effective, high potent drug, and now we're testing it in phase two trial, which are listed here, one for URI and the second for LRTI, which it's already up and running and looking at different primary endpoint, but we can use standard of care. which is good. That's why we are part of this study, because standard of care for us, it is arusidase ribavirin. And we are, you know, we are allowed to use that, and versus their drug versus the placebo, hopefully they can have a good way analyzing the big drop in viral load, or the delta drop in viral load, or maybe the AUC under the curve viral load, to see if they have any impact, additional impact of their, you know, of their drug. So I was cautioning them, because arusidase, I know it will drop their viral load pretty quickly. So if they're getting placebo and ribavirin, I don't know what's going to be the impact. But they're pretty sure about their potency of their drug. They want to move this forward, and hopefully by next season, we're late into the season to get this approved by our IRB. I know Michael had experience with it, and few of his patients who got this drug as well versus placebo. So hopefully we'll have some data by next season as well. So what we recommend is treat only moderate to high risk. You don't have to treat low risk. And also preemptive therapy at the URI stage, very important, have impact on mortality. Intermittent schedule, I don't think anyone will argue about that for now. But IVIG, I think the questions still need to be answered, and hopefully in some study in the future. Few slides on para-influenza, you know, to finish. We know there's no antiviral therapy for specific for para-influenza. So if you're telling me you can use placebo, of course, that's what we do every day. We don't have a treatment for it. So it's a good virus to study in our patient population if we have a new drug for it. Although ribavirin in vitro work against it, but based on some data from our center and from other centers, maybe it's not the way to go. We were not that impressed with arusidase ribavirin. What we do actually in our center, we use IVIG because of the anti-inflammatory effect as well. And, you know, people usually feel better after you give them a few doses of IVIG. This is the data on our stem cell transplant patient and leukemia patient, where we see that leukemia, actually, bigger number of patients progress to pneumonia with PIV than the stem cell transplant. It's around 20 versus 39%. But at the end, same mortality rate from PIV pneumonia, between 17 and 18%. No difference between the two group, treat or not treat. I'm not going to talk much about treatment, but we didn't find much difference if they were treated with ribavirin or not. The good news, we have a new inhaled drug, the S181, tested in phase 2 trial now. It's a viral receptor inhibitor, actually, the sialic acid. It block it and block entry of the influenza or para-influenza into the cells. This is in vitro. And this is actually the first case to show big impact of using the S181 for severe para-influenza infection, lung transplant recipient. And as you can see here, patient was intubated, not doing well. And when they give him the first dose of this inhaled, the S181, you can see the viral load dropping, and patient was extubated and did well. So this at least one evidence anecdotal, but it's something pretty impressive in this case, what happened when they used the S181. And now we have the phase 2 randomized double-blind placebo-controlled study with the S181. We used it in a few of our patients as open label. Some of the patients did pretty well. Well, now we use it on probably around 8 randomized placebo versus versus the drug, active drug, and we don't know. We had a few deaths. The only problem with this trial, the primary endpoint is mortality at day 45. And as you know, stem cell transplant, mortality at day 45, tons of stuff can happen. It's probably not from PIV. Maybe climbing the stairs and falling down, it can kill them. But this is what the FDA actually mandated. They want to see significant impact, and mortality is the way to go to look at significant outcome. But at day 45, it makes sense. But this was based on actually our data and Michael's data, how determined the patient, they're going to die, they're going to die later, but not at day 45, usually a little bit before that. So that's what we're doing, and hopefully we can have some data, because this is exciting. Hopefully it will work against para-influenza pneumonia. So to conclude, CRV or common respiratory viruses, I talked about only two. There's so many others. Yeah, they can cause serious infection in our stem cell transplant and leukemia patient. And also, we have something we can use, at least in RSV. And for influenza, I didn't talk about it much, but neuraminidase inhibitors work very nicely. The only problem is use it early. If you use it late, you get worse outcome. Early on, every 24 hours count, you can have much better outcome with zero mortality from it, and probably even zero progression to pneumonia as well. So, and I want to acknowledge my research team, my collaboration with Baylor, as well as with stem cell transplant. Without them, we cannot enroll the patient on all this trial. Thank you.